Now, this excerpt I'm going to be reading to you today is the introductory section on Milton by Harold Bloom in his book, a marvelous, marvelous anthology called The Best Poems of the English Language, from Chaucer through Robert Frost. Now, it's a great book, perhaps a bit dense in certain parts, but very detailed and very opinionated in all the ways that I usually like. He does have somewhat of a Jewish spin on things, but I'm sure you'll find it somewhat fascinating, and I hope you learn something and perhaps even decide to check the book out. Anyways, enjoy. No poet since John Milton, in English, approaches his good eminence. Not Blake, Wordsworth, Whitman, Dickinson, Yeats, Stevens. Except for Shakespeare, no poet has been so influential. From John Dryden to T.S. Eliot, Milton has been a provocation and a shadow. In dedication to his vocation of becoming a great poet-prophet, Milton has an intensity and a drive that rivals Dante. Each desired both poetic immortality and the redemption of his people. The imperial politics of Dante and the republican hopes of Milton alike came to ruin. For the last 19 of his 56 years, Dante was an exile from Florence. At 51, Milton, already totally blind for 7 years, endured imprisonment, after suffering the strong possibility of dreadful public execution for defending regicide. Hanging, being cut down alive, having one's private parts cut off, one's entrails ripped from the body, and only then being beheaded. The Florentines sentenced Dante to be burned alive. The English very nearly incurred the permanent disgrace of butchering their epic poet, who a decade later completed the composition of Paradise Lost. The world came close to possessing neither the Commedia nor Paradise Lost. When Franco's fascists murdered Federico Garcia Lorca, aged 38, they deprived Spain of its greatest lyric poet. The Tuscans and Stuart royalists, who would have destroyed even greater aesthetic splendors. John Milton is so large a form of thought, passion, and invention that his long sense of being a late developer can puzzle even his most informed admirers. On his 24th birthday, December 9th, 1632, he composed a troubled sonnet. How soon hath time, the subtle thief of youth, stolen on his wing, my 23rd year, my hasting days, fly on with full career, but my late spring, no bud or blossom shooth. Perhaps my semblance might deceive the truth, that I to manhood am arrived so near, and inward ripeness doth much less appear, that some more timely, happy spirits endeth. Yet be it less or more, or soon or slow, it shall be still, in strictest measure even, to that same lot, however mean or high, towards which time leads me, and the will of heaven. All is, if I have grace to use it so, as ever in my great task-maker's eye. Milton had already written permanent poems, including On the Morning of Christ's Nativity and the matchless, rather Shakespearean, extended lyrics El Allegro and El Penseroso. And yet, he is perfectly serious in this sonnet, as only the most ambitious of all poets can be. One wonders just who those more timely, happy spirits could have been. Scholars have suggested two Cambridge contemporaries, the poet Thomas Randolph and Edward King, the clergyman whose drowning was to provide the occasion for Milton's magnificent elegy, Lyticus, 5 years later, in 1637. Randolph, and still less King, were hardly Miltonic in poetic accomplishment, yet the young Milton laments his supposed lack of bud or blossom, despite the Il Allegro, Il Penseroso, lyrical astonishments. There is no need to doubt the sincerity of this, but it shows considerable self-mystification on the poet's part. How Soon Hath Time is, for Milton, a very minor poem, but its anxieties are revelations. Hidden in the sonnet is a Miltonic tension between knowing that he needed time for his massive gifts to mature and his fear that an untimely death might prevent that maturation. When, In the period from 1665 to 1669, the blind poet was able to finish and publish Paradise Lost. He won a great victory over fate and worldly defeat, comparable to Dante's successful completion of the Commedia. Milton's best biographer, Barbara Lewalski, usefully emphasizes that his epic is not a retreat into isolated spirituality. Quote, "It takes a strenuous project of educating readers in the virtues, values, and attitudes that make a people worthy of liberty." Milton's greatest poetry was composed after he turned 57, an age neither Dante nor Shakespeare reached. Among modern poets, several also broke into a new splendor after that age: Thomas Hardy, W.B. Yeats, Wallace Stevens. But you would have to go back to Sophocles to find a paradigm for Milton's extraordinary late flowering in Samson Agonistes, which may well have been written after his 60th birthday. Poet-prophet that he was, Milton was accurate to his own poetic career, long choosing and beginning late. Since Paradise Lost is the Protestant epic proper, the arch-heretical Milton has been subsumed by one Protestant orthodoxy or another for more than three centuries now. In precisely what sense is Paradise Lost a Christian poem? You can have a Protestant sensibility without being Christian, as Samuel Beckett demonstrated. The historian Christopher Hill opens onto the true scandal of Milton's supposed Christianity. Milton's virtual abandonment of the idea of sacrificial atonement, his failure to emphasize the miracles of the New Testament, including the Incarnation, the Resurrection, the Ascension, and the Pentecost, all make an approach verge on the secular. The critic A.D. Natal goes even further, as I would, in questioning whether Milton, at 66, facing death, could still be termed a Christian. William Blake and Emily Dickinson were sects of one, and so was their heroic precursor, John Milton. Concerning Shakespeare's religion, we know absolutely nothing. He was secretly Catholic, Protestant, or nihilist? It does not matter, because the plays proclaim everything and nothing. Dante's Anglo-American scholars have assimilated him to Augustine and Aquinas. His Italian critics, more sensibly, emphasize his pride and individuality. As Dante, so Milton, no fiercer poetic selves ever existed. I began this book's general commentary with an analysis of poetry as an art of strangeness, following the critics Walter Pater and Owen Barfield. Pater defined romanticism as the adding of strangeness to beauty. Barfield characterizes authentic poetry as a strangeness of meaning. Paradise Lost becomes a stranger to me each time I reread it or recite it to myself. The poet-critic William Epson, in his splendid Milton's God, compared the unmatched English epic to archaic Benin, West African, sculpture, barbarously beautiful. Empson, Maoist and anti-Christian, felt that Milton had just barely managed to keep his temper with the poem's God. As a Gnostic Jew, in rebellion against normative Judaism and Christianity alike, I find Milton's God the principal blot upon an otherwise magnificent poem, whose strangeness makes such a God irrelevant and aesthetically inadequate, since there is nothing at all strange about the supposed God of Paradise Lost. He is self-righteous, irascible, and anxious. William Blake accurately termed him a schoolmaster of souls. You have to be a dogmatic Christian whose values are not aesthetic to find this God attractive. Still, though he is called God, he is only a secondary representation of the divine in the poem. Christ, I hasten to add, is only tertiary. The primary transcendental agent in Paradise Lost is the Holy Spirit, not the third person in the Trinity, but the inner light of Protestant descent, exalted by Milton's close friend, Sir Henry Vane, martyred by the restored Stuarts, by the Muggletonians and other visionaries, and certainly by Milton himself. In the Christian Doctrine, his posthumously published theology, Milton dutifully ranks the Son over the Holy Spirit. But what do we find in the rich strangeness of the poem? I hold to an observation I first printed many years ago that Christ of Paradise Lost is a kind of armored commander, a heavenly Rommel or Paton, who mounts his father's flaming chariot, Merkaba in Hebrew, which is also the name of the Israeli battle tank, and leads the angelic host in the fight that thrusts Satan and his host out of the skies into the depths of the abyss. The fire of the chariot ignites the falling demons, and the impact of Satan's legions upon the bottom of the deep creates hell. Milton cannot have been unaware that his poem's Christ, thus, is the pragmatic creator of hell. If Milton lacks any central human and literary quality, it is the comic sense. What did he expect his Christian readers to make of the Miltonic crucifixion? But to the cross he nails thy enemies, the law that is against thee, and the sins of all mankind with him there crucified, never to hurt them more who rightly trust. In this his satisfaction, so he dies, but soon revives. Book 7, lines 415 through 420. My italics highlight 6 words, broken by an enjambment, which are all this vast poem devotes to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Milton's haste in getting Christ off the cross reflects profound uneasiness with the incarnation and with the atonement. Why does he bother with the cross at all? But it brings us to the greatest mystery of Paradise Lost and its poet. How fully aware is he that there are 2 gods in his epic, the static setter of limits and the dynamic deity of becoming, totally free of the Calvinist model? Perhaps the most extraordinary aspect of Paradise Lost is that, by its close, Milton's God undergoes a metamorphosis in which he has become one with the Holy Spirit who inspires and guides Milton's composition of the poem. Aidan Attall surprisingly observes, quote, "The new God who emerges at the end of Paradise Lost is begotten of the Father, the tyrant. I descend only from that begotten. The second God emanates from Milton's inner light, the Holy Spirit that has made Milton her temple." Angus Fletcher, whom I cited in my introductory commentary as an authority upon poetic thinking, terms Paradise Lost neither tragic nor romantic, but a suspension upon a threshold, the border between life and death. The speed of light, always inward in Milton, is one with the speed of his poetic thinking. That speed is Milton's new God, and comes in the invocation to Book 3, long before the epic's conclusion. "Hail, holy light, offspring of heaven, firstborn, or of the eternal, coternal beam, may I express the unblamed, since God is light, and never but in unapproached light, dwelt from eternity, dwelt in thee, bright effluence of bright essence increate. Or hear'st thou, rather pure, ethereal stream, whose fountain who shall tell, before the sun, before the heavens thou wert, and at the voice of God, as with a mantle didst invest the rising world of waters dark and deep." Milton mingles allusions to the opening of the Gospel of John with Psalm 104 in these intricate 11 lines, which emphasize the creation of Genesis 1, but with a difference that is Milton's own, based upon his own lonely experience of creating his poem. We know that the blind prophet bard composed at night, molding his marvelous verse paragraphs, and then dictated them in the morning. His epic worships light, yet he knows only darkness. The poem is a drama for the theater of 2 minds, Milton's and the reader's. Most of us who encounter Paradise Lost can read it. We can see. I always have been fascinated by my blind students or other sightless auditors of Milton whom I have met through the years. They tend to know Milton through the ear, listening to readers or to recordings, though some have had access to Paradise Lost in Braille, at least in part. Milton assumes his reader can see, but the blind have a particular affinity for his rich-sounding style. Sometimes I close my own eyes and recite Paradise Lost out loud to myself, when alone, a habit I first practiced as a child, when I came to possess the poem by memory, that coming easy to me then. My experience can only be an approximation of my blind students, yet I come to share something of their sense of being domesticated in the sublime poem's warmth and light. I mean sublime in its precise literary sense, raised aloft, replete with power, which in Milton is disciplined wildness, that is, wildness in its meaning of freedom. Closing one's eyes and reciting aloud, say, the invocation to light that starts book three, is to know directly the new God of Paradise Lost. Not a tyrannical schoolmaster of souls, but what Angus Fletcher calls the prolongation of the prophetic moment, the modulated breath that is the narrator's voice in Milton's epic. By voice, I mean a Miltonic metaphor, an image of voice that features movements of rising to heights and falling to depths, movements incessant, almost obsessive, throughout the poem. I find it extraordinary to recite, or hear others recite, long passages of Paradise Lost while my eyes are closed, because the imagery of rising and falling takes on a boundless outline, the grand reverberation of Miltonic voice. Him, the almighty power, hurled headlong flaming from the eternal sky, with hideous ruin and combustion down, to bottomless perdition there to dwell, in adamantine chains and penal fire. No single metaphor will serve for Milton's image of voice, the way Tally splendidly serves as Walt Whitman's, but Fall or Falling does quite well. Of the poem's two falls, the angels and men's, I hardly know which is rendered more gloriously. The first gives us Satan, the second deepens Eve, the two most interesting figures in Milton. I use figure advisedly because Satan and Eve and Adam are not persons, as the wife of Bath and Falstaff or the partner in Iago are living personalities. After their fall, Eve and Adam are supposed to be representations of mortality, like ourselves. But Milton's art has more in common with Dante's than with Shakespeare's or Chaucer's. But then, I do not know what either Shakespeare or Chaucer might have done with the hard task of representing mortal enigmas. I never feel that the reader is Eve or Adam, but for certain moments, in the darkness of voice, I can identify with Milton, the prophet, or with the sublime Satan. Criticism from the start regarded Satan as a perversion of the heroic, but from childhood on, I have agreed with Blake and Shelley, rather than with the editorializing Milton, who emerges frequently to damn his superbly rhetorical hero. If you love poetry, then you love Satan. Iago, an even greater creation, frightens me, but Iago's endless to meditation as a psychology, while Satan is closer to Melville's Captain Ahab in Moby Dick, or Judge Holden in Cormac McCarthy's Blood Meridian, three grand figurations, but lacking the fascinations of Iago's personality. Though Satan is not a person, he is an extraordinary vision of consciousness, in Owen Barfield's sense of a strangeness of meaning. In Shakespeare, consciousness seems almost an effortless given. Hamlet, Falstaff, Iago, Cleopatra, all give us the impression that they apprehend more widely than we do. Milton's genius is of a different kind, again, closer to Dante's than to Shakespeare's or Chaucer's. All consciousness in Milton is heroic, because it is somehow his own, whether satanic or human, whether fallen or unfallen. We never know when consciousness is his own, even in the sonnets, because of their uncanny detachment. Milton's particular greatness is his transformation of his own profound passions, his hopes for the human, into an art absolutely personal, yet also near universal. Here, I want to describe Milton's particular genius for stationing himself in literary tradition so as to make his forerunners into his descendants, and to overshadow his many actual poetic descendants, even when they possess the genius of a Keats or a Shelley. Milton was a learned poet with extraordinary linguistic mastery. Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Italian, French, and other modern languages, including Dutch. In regard to the poetic riches of the past, Milton boldly attempted to subsume not less than everything. If there was a single flaw in his recondite awareness of every precedent and each precursor, it would be Shakespeare, most dangerous of influences. The only indeliberate allusions or unintended echoes of forerunners that I can uncover in Paradise Lost invariably turn out to be Shakespearean. Milton is adept at making himself seem early or first, and Homer, Virgil, Lucretius, Ovid, Camoens, Tasso, Spenser, and even the Bible seem late, some of which I will demonstrate in regard to particular passages. Only the debt to Shakespeare could not be overcome. Satan's sense of injured merit is Iago's, and Belial in the debate in hell spookily echoes Claudio confronting the likelihood of death in Measure for Measure. To be the foremost poet in the English language after the death of Shakespeare cannot be regarded as a defeat.